This month marks the one-year anniversary of lockdown in this country due to the coronavirus pandemic. An unintended consequence is being waged on the mental health of thousands. Joining us to talk about it is Hope Edelman, grief coach and author of The Aftergrief, Finding Your Way Along the Long Arc of Grief. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me. Pleasure.
And congratulations on your new book. It came out in October, and we'll tell everybody where they can get it. But I want to discuss the difference when we're talking about mental health. When we hear about issues during the pandemic, a lot of it's due to isolation. Is isolation and grief mutually exclusive?
Well, we tend to think of grief as the response that we have after someone dies. But really, grief is something that we can experience anytime we experience a loss. And loss often comes as a result of change, especially when change is unexpected or unwanted, like so many of the changes were in 2020. We are leaving something behind. We lost a whole way of life in 2020. I mean, we lost more than 500,000 people. But in addition to COVID, 2.8 million to other causes of deaths, countless jobs, classroom learning, access to our social networks, freedom of movement for a while. So whenever those things happen, we have a response to that loss, and that response I legitimately can be called grief.
And how would you define grief?
I would define it as the body and the soul, spirits and the mind's attempt to adjust to a change that involves loss, often an unwanted one. It's physical, it's emotional, it's psychological, it's spiritual. It's also social, which means we need the village to help us through it. And we haven't had that this past year because we've been in isolation, and that's been a real problem for many.
And for people who you've coached who read your book, who would be interested in reading your book because they are suffering from it, how do you identify it and what are some of the manifestations of grief? Because sometimes people are just kind of clueless. You know, they just go through life and maybe they're feeling kind of down, but they don't know why. Mm-hmm. What are some of the specific manifestations of grief?
Well, grief can look and feel a lot like depression, and it often is confused with depression. And if grief comes up in someone who is predisposed to depression or anxiety, it can turn into what is known as complicated grief, which is when the grief channel gets turned on 24/7 and we can't get out of that. It's a lot of feelings of helplessness, despair. Our sleep may be disturbed. Our appetites may be disturbed. We may have physical symptoms. It's very, very, see, grief is so individual. It's hard to say what it would be like in your body because it would show up differently in my body. We think about the person all the time. We're pining for them. There are feminine styles of grief and masculine styles of grief, and they look very different. The feminine is more to emote, to talk, to reach out to others. The male is more to go interior, to problem solve, to grieve through action. So it's going to look, if there's 100 people in a room, there are going to be 100 different ways that grief will appear.
Right. And people often hear the five stages of grief, but you say that isn't necessarily so.
You know, that is not true for most people, and it was never intended to be true for most people. Those five stages of grief were actually originally the five stages of dying. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross observed them in the terminally ill. I think of grief really, I think there's really only two stages of grief that people care about. There's the one where you feel really, really bad and it's acute, fresh grief. And there's the one where you start feeling better and you realize I can get through this. I'm going to feel joy again. And you find a way to carry that person or that loss with you forward. That's what I call the after grief. I think that's the second phase, and that extends for the rest of your life.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is a perfect place to take a break. When we come back, I want to talk about how one deals with grief. What are the healthy ways of managing grief, especially during these times? So we're going to do that in 2 minutes. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back. We've been chatting with Hope Edelman. She's a grief coach, and she's the author of The Aftergrief, a really interesting book for people. I think everybody can relate to this because that's what brings us together is the common fact that we have all suffered loss in our life, but there are healthy ways of dealing with it and there are not so healthy ways of dealing with it. But one thing I wanted to ask you, Hope, is when someone is grieving, you know, to not get lost in this vortex of depression or some of these bad habits that can come out of this, but what about using the time to reflect on people that you have lost in your life or things that have happened to you? Is that a good thing, or is it best to just kind of stay busy and just kind of get over it?
It really depends on the individual. Some people are temperamentally suited to reach out to others and talk and process through speaking. And for them, talking to a trusted friend or therapist can be enormously helpful. Other people are more interior, and for them, they may not need to externalize it through writing, through art. Some people are very physical and get their you need to get your bodies moving in that case. Go for walks, be out in nature. Nature is so forgiving. But you're right, there are ways that we'd like to avoid. I was just reading this morning how much alcohol consumption went up in the past year. Oh, yeah. And so instead of reaching for those forms of self-medication, we might think about how to use our bodies in other ways, how to reach out to others. But that's hard. You know, we're isolated at home. We're reaching out by Zoom. So we need to make that extra effort, see people where and when we can as things open up, and find others who can understand what you're feeling. If that doesn't mean necessarily someone who has also lost a job, it might mean someone who can be empathetic to going through that so that we feel that we have the support system we need, because anyone going through a loss or grieving will adjust better in the long term if they feel they have adequate support.
In this day and age, though, like you just said, we have all of these resources and ways in which we can reach out to somebody, whether it's over the computer through a Zoom call, whether it's over the phone, whether it's through texting or social media. I mean, there's myriad ways, so many more than we ever had in our past, to reach out. So what is it that keeps someone either locked inside of themselves, that they're unable to see that they have help, that's just a phone call away? What would you recommend for those people to do to know that they don't have to be alone?
Well, people are often worried that they will burden others if they call or Zoom or text and talk about their distress. But oftentimes what we find, or what I find, is that the people on the other end are grateful for the opportunity to help somebody else, especially in times of need. So we need to keep in mind that oftentimes we are giving someone a gift if we are allowing them to support us or to help us, rather than automatically thinking, I'm going to burden or depress the person on the other end. And if you have a team of people that you know can hold that space for you or can contain those emotions for you, it takes their mind off of their problems for a while too. And sometimes they're grateful for that. So I think those are the people you want to try to reach out to in whatever way you can.
Definitely. And there's so many resources out there for people, even the people you don't know, that's out there ready to take your call, that's ready to help. And I think that's really important for people to know that. And as far as your coaching, I know you're located in California. Do you provide coaching across the country? I know people can get your book wherever they are, and that has a wealth of information. But how do they go about retaining your services or finding someone who can help them in their local community?
Well, I do individual and group coaching by Zoom and by Skype and FaceTime. I also have Tuesday evening calls every week just for women who've lost their mothers, motherless daughters, which is the topic of my first book. So we have community calls every Tuesday night. And then there are motherless daughters groups online all over Facebook. There's an aftergrief community group on Facebook too that's quite active, where people are talking about losses, not just losses now, but losses in the past, because those of us who lost someone even decades ago are finding that it's bubbling up and resurging now, because what we're experiencing now is triggering memories of loss in the past, particularly adults who lost parents or siblings when they were young are feeling some of those same emotions again.
Absolutely. And so many of us, if we've lost someone that we care deeply about, you'll just be driving along and the tears will start flowing because something triggers it. And
that's exactly what the aftergrief is about. You just nailed it.
Yeah. Well, wonderful. Hope Edelman, I want to thank you so much. Again, her book is The Aftergrief, Finding Your Way Along the Long Arc of Grief. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me.
We're back after this.